Rockschool, the program that examines how you make music in a rock band. And in this series, we're going to be looking at synthesizers and keyboards and how new technology has changed the face and the sound of modern music.
We'll also be looking at a vital part of any band's sound, which is often underrated by musicians just starting out, the lead and harmony vocals. The voice, after all, is an instrument too. And to get it sounding good, you have to work on it.
But don't worry if you're a guitarist, a bassist, or even a drummer. We've got plenty of things to interest you too. Rock School, after all, is as much about playing in a band as looking at individual instruments. And we're going to be examining how the addition of the keyboards, the synthesizers, and vocals affects what we play on the drums, the bass, and the guitar.
Once again, we went out and talked to some of the world's leading players to pick up hints and tips on their approach to playing. Here are just a few of the faces that will be appearing in this new series of Rock School.
We're here.
When you practice, you don't have headphones on. You're hearing a room.
You can actually get the things to hang over between the things, which is the other thing.
I couldn't imagine that I would ever need a memory.
It's about three and a half octaves. Add a push on a good day.
I'm going to get in the corner.
Have a bit of fun.
There actually isn't real music on the compact disc.
So, let's get started with a closer look at some of these synths and keyboards. And the man with the daunting task of unravelling it all, our new recruit, the brilliant Alistair Gubbin.
Thanks, Jeff. Well, brilliant wasn't quite the words used in rehearsal. Anyway, the noise I make comes from these instruments. For example, this synth gives me this great sound we heard in our opening piece. Or I can link up several synths via this sequencer to produce a sophisticated backing track at the touch of a button. Or I can faithfully reproduce chunks of sound called samples and play them just like you would any other machine, using this machine, a sampler.
Well, with all this new technology, some musicians have had to acquire the skills of programming and sequencing, just as you would do the more conventional techniques of fingering and coordination.
But it hasn't always been like this. Not so long ago, rock keyboards were limited by and large to the electric piano, the organ, one or two exotic additions like the clavinet, and of course the good old acoustic piano. Instruments which you didn't have to program, you just played.
But the most significant advance in electronic keyboards came with the synthesizer, a machine based on an experimental tradition going back to the early 1900s, but which only came into its own in rock music during the 60s and 70s.
The synthesizer is not strictly a keyboard instrument like the piano. Its keyboard is only a sound controller, and as such, you can have other forms of controller, like the guitar, bass, or drums. And we're going to be looking at these later on in Rock School.
The keyboard was originally favoured by synth designers like Bob Moog and Alan Perlman because it was the easiest way of telling the synth which notes were being played. The keys act as switches, turning on or off the signals which produce the notes. From a playing point of view, synthesizers gave access to a whole new range of sounds and effects. But a major limitation of these early keyboards was their lack of touch sensitivity.
Touch sensitivity is an important way of creating expression on an instrument. Take the bass, for example. Now, if I pluck the string softly, it creates a quiet sound. As I pluck harder, the note gets louder. Now, I can change the tone again by strumming with my nails like this. And by slapping and pulling the strings, I create a different effect again. sensitivity is common to guitar, bass, drums, and piano, as you'll hear in this next piece.
Despite all the technological advances made in recent years, some musicians still prefer using the acoustic piano because of its versatility and expressiveness. Here's Richard Coles of the Communards.
Well, the reason why I like playing it so much is because it is such a versatile instrument, and you can use it in that sort of way, just as a sort of form of, you know, chords and stuff like that. But also it can be a single line instrument and do a lot more decorative stuff, a lot more melodic stuff as well, or a combination of the two. So, I mean, is it so amazing?
Because we use it in one of our songs, Bedline Britain, and it doesn't just become, I mean, it becomes really powerful in certain parts. Certain parts, this tends to just be in the background, but then certain parts it really takes over, becomes really dominant.
Have that sort of immediate actual sort of physical control over the mechanics of it, which means if you want to go loud, you can go loud, and it's not a question of sort of bumping up a level or things like that. It's a purely mechanical response. So you do get a really nice sort of immediate live feeling from a piano, which you don't get off an electronic instrument, really.
Basically, a piano key is on the path to the actual thing that produces the sound, which is the string. The way you hit the key, the volume and the speed with which you hit the key determines how the sound is going to be. These things are completely different. These keys are only switches. Volume happens to be a parameter that's controlled by the speed only that this key goes down. So the whole system is different, and at this point synthesizers are still not quite as sensitive. You can't get all the nuances out of the synthesizers with your fingers that you can out of an acoustic piano, but that day will come.
Besides a lack of touch sensitivity, early synths had two other main drawbacks. You couldn't memorize sound settings, so that you had to reprogram manually every time you wanted a new sound. And secondly, if you wanted to play polyphonically, more than one note at a time, you had to use synths in a modular form, which meant that you usually ended up with a backache and a huge overdraft. They looked and sounded something like this. Notice especially the potted plant.
A major breakthrough came in the early 70s with an instrument called the Mini Moog, known to many in the UK as the Mini Moog. Portable and reliable with a recognisable sound, keyboard players still remember the excitement caused by the Moog's first arrival. This is Miami Vice maestro Jan Hammer.
I always dreamt of an instrument that I could do things like what horn players or violinists or even things like singers could do. And piano seemed to be the only one that really just didn't leave you any room to stretch in that way, like bending notes, sliding. And I kept imagining, you know, putting things on the piano, like on a harp, you know, where you could move strings. And with the organ, you could only do it if you turn this switch on and off. The organ didn't like that. And then it was all kinds of interim solutions, like putting devices on electric piano that would give you a little bit more stretch. And when I finally got my hands on a Mini Moog, it was that was the instrument. And I knew from that point on, that was my voice.
But as yet, the Mini Moog was still only monophonic, only able to play one note at a time, so keyboard players found themselves carting loads of gear around to get their solo and chord work sounds. Some players will admit they got a bit carried away.
This sort of setup just wasn't practical for most players, and manufacturers in the early days did their best to produce synthesizers which were both polyphonic and programmable. An early polyphonic machine was the Mellotron, which used tape samples of strings and choirs, and was popular with bands like Genesis and Yes. Delightful. But the Mellotron was incredibly unreliable when it came to performing live. Genesis keyboard player Tony Banks.
The Mellotron was a notorious instrument. It was put together, the early one I had, which was a sort of great big thing. I mean, they really did make it out of whatever they could lay their hands on. It used bicycle chains and vacuum cleaner motors, you know. And they had these ridiculous large kind of drums with tape on them. And I mean, incredible technique of searching the tapes to find the right tone and everything, which they had. And the whole system just went wrong all the time. And we had to use it. We got to the stage we were rebuilding it every night because it was structurally so unsound, and it was real chaos.
The breakthrough came in 1978 in the shape of the Prophet 5. With five voices and originally the capacity to store 40 different sound settings, it was well ahead of the string machines and other oddities that passed for polyphony at that time. It had a distinctive range of warm, rich tones and can be heard in the pop music of the late 70s and early 80s. Do you remember this track from Japan?
Just when I think I'm winning, when I've broken every door, the ghosts of my life blow wilder than before. Just when I thought I could not be stopped, when my chance came to begin, the ghosts of my life blow wilder. Then the wind.
secret of the Prophet 5 was its combination of analog and digital technology to create sounds and memorize them. Now, you might all have heard the terms analog and digital bandied around a lot of music. And certainly, when it comes to synthesis, it's important to understand the difference between them.
All early synths were analog, that's voltage controlled. Many modern synths from the Prophet 5 onwards are analog too, but with an element of digital technology in them, in the form of a microcomputer, used to memorize sound settings and recall them instantly. Now, analog synths create sound by generating an electric current using oscillators, and then filtering out certain frequencies and shaping it with the envelopes. Fully digital synths, however, use computer technology to create much more complex waveforms, and therefore much more accurate imitations of other instruments. These waveforms are generated mathematically in binary code and aren't subject to the degeneration that voltages suffer by being pushed through a circuit board. This makes for a much cleaner and clearer sound than analog synths are able to produce.
Of course, it's not just keyboard players that benefit from clearer, cleaner sounds. Another area in which digital technology has made an impact is with effects pedals, or in this case, rack-mounted effects units. Now, in this rack, you can see there are two multi-effects processors. They can produce lots of different digital effects, from chorusing, flanging, through to different kinds of reverbs. I've already added on a reverb to the sound, but you might hear it change as I add on some stereo chorus. Finally, I'm going to add on a long delay, and with these three effects, you can create this kind of sound.
So, how does a synth work? Well, at its simplest, a synthesizer converts voltage into sound waves. Now, sound has three main elements: pitch, timbre or tone color, and loudness or amplitude. Pitch and timbre are determined by oscillators, which are the basic source of sound in a synth, and these are defined respectively by their range and their wave shape. The purest waveform you can get is a sine wave, which you can hear in this sound. The sawtooth waveform is usually used for brass type sounds. And the square waveform gives a thinner sound, which is useful for string sounds. Okay, let's put this all into practice. Take it away, team. One, two. One part I might play with this backing is this percussive type sound. Here, oscillator 1 is set a sine wave to give us our basic pitch. Oscillator 2 is set higher to give us the effect of sticks hitting an instrument, as on a marimba. The envelope section here is generally shapes the sound and is set to a zero attack time, so the sound is instantaneous. If I lengthen the attack time, you'll hear the effect of the sticks disappearing. Also, it's set with a very short release time. Alternatively, I might play the sustained sound. Here, both oscillators are set to a square wave for a string-like sound. The filter envelope, which shapes the tone color of the sound, is set to a slow attack so that the brightness fades in gradually, as you can hear. The loudness envelope is also set to a slow attack time, so each note appears gradually. Okay, let's make a noise.
Because synthesizer control is now in digital form, it means the synths can talk to each other, or even other digital devices such as sequencers, drum machines, or even computers. This is all down to a magical device known as MIDI, and in the next session of Rock School, we're going to be looking at MIDI.
But for now, we'll leave you with one of the pioneers of synthesizer musicianship, Thomas Dolby.